Hello, wherever you are, a very, very warm welcome to yet another edition of your weekly international current affairs program, Globe Watch, from the Cameroon Radio Television with me, Charles Buni. Across the Mediterranean, it is a tragedy because people from Middle East and Africa have made attempts to cross into Europe, but many of them have died in the course of the week. At least on Sunday, 800 immigrants died across the Mediterranean as Sicily, the main entry center into Italy, is overwhelmed by the current migrant crisis. The European Union has met to discuss a strategy on how they can best solve the problem. Why African countries and Middle East governments directly concerned by the issue are yet to make a comment. So how do we prevent illegal immigration across the Mediterranean? My guest today has been working on the immigration issue for long and heads the Center for Strategic Studies. Dr. Christian Poo, thanks very much for coming on Globe Watch once more again.
Thanks for the invitation, Charles.
Let me just give you some statistics. The International Organization for Migration states that 2,447 migrants died last year. 1,750 people have died this year alone. That is about 30% as much as high the same period last year. The worst is probably yet to come, right?
Yes, I think the issue of international migration, particularly from Africa to Europe, has returned to the headlines because of the huge death tolls that has been noticed these last weeks. And the figures you are sharing with us are very interesting because they really display how huge the reality is. What I can say is that the years 2013 and 2014 has been very critical on this issue of migration because you had the Operation Mare Nostrum launched by, run by the Italian government on the Mediterranean Sea. And this Mare Nostrum operation was stopped in October 2014. And after Mare Nostrum was stopped and replaced by Operation Triton, you had we witnessed a double
or an increase,
a serious increase on the numbers of migrants trying to reach Europe by the sea through the Mediterranean. And the figures are impressive because the Libya has become one of the poorest areas through which migrants pass to get to Europe. And there is no watch that is done in Libya. There is no monitoring that is done in Libya on all these migratory flows.
You are just talking of Libya because about 21,000 people are estimated to have reached Italy alone this year. Yeah. And we have about 13,000 others crossing into the Eastern Mediterranean and over 1,800 reaching Spain. Why has Libya become such a huge transit corridor?
You know, in 2011, the European government, France, Great Britain launched an operation to remove a dictator called Gaddafi from power. And after this operation, as you know, Gaddafi were killed, and the government in Libya has never been able to manage to rule the country properly. So you have an area which is called Misrata, which is less than 400 kilometers from the Lampedusa coast in Italy. Mm-hmm. And this has become an area where flows of migrants come and stay, looking for opportunity to cross the Mediterranean Sea. This is the first thing. The second thing is that in most of the countries surrounding Libya, particularly Mauritania and Morocco, trafficking of illegal immigrants has become more interesting than drug trafficking and more lucrative. So you have an illicit economy around immigrants, illegal trafficking, which has become very much lucrative and which which attracts smugglers from everywhere. That it has become a kind of industry, and Libya is the turning point of that industry. And the second thing is that after the replacement of Gaddafi government, there have been no policies by the international community to try to correct and to preserve Libyan frontiers. So from the south of Libya, you can go everywhere in Europe, particularly when you cross the sea, you reach Italy. You can also from the Mediterranean Sea go back to Spain, go back to Malta, go back to Malta, Spain, and to Greece. Mm-hmm. So all these uncontrolled areas are gateways for illegal immigrants.
Doctor, you are just talking about the smuggling of migrants, their trafficking here becoming like an industry. Yeah. When you talk to some of those who have survived, they will tell you that they paid at least $700. That is about 450 CFA francs. Some of them paid up to $7,000. That should be around 3.5 million CFA francs, yeah, to reach Europe. Yeah. But these are people who are complaining of poverty to enter into Europe. Just try to explain to me, why are Africans or people from the Middle East increasingly going to Europe or trying to enter into Europe illegally and spending huge sums of money which they may have invested in their own countries?
Yeah, I think it is because of the hope. The hope for better life is more important for them than staying where they are. It is clear that when you can have somebody who is able to spend $1,000 just to cross the sea, without knowing what is waiting for him at the next frontier, it's a question. But you cannot isolate this just on hope. It is also a question of governance. It is a question of economic policy in the countries of departure. It is a question of fear, because don't forget that one of the most huge flows of migrants is coming from Syria now. It is coming also from the Horn of Africa. All these territories have, unfortunately, issues of instability and of war, particularly about Syria. So I think the explanation is not just only a monetary explanation or the capacity of spending something. It is the capacity of thinking, where are the better conditions? Where do I want to live with my family? Because it is not a question of I am crossing the sea for a better life just for me. I am crossing the sea for a better life for me and my family. You also have this migration policies in Europe, which constitute a factor of appeal to this country. The policies regarding what we call the family policies, mm-hmm, where you can cross the sea, mm-hmm, obtain, be regularized, and mm-hmm, invite your family. Mm-hmm. I think it is all these factors that create
the social protection policy,
and the attraction for Europe is too powerful for these people who live in areas where there is almost no hope.
Okay, let me just push you on one of the factors you just mentioned, the economic, or if you like, the financial factor. Yep. Some of these migrants, they will tell you that they want to go to Greece. They are coming from countries like Cameroon, countries like Nigeria, countries like the Sudan. But you and I know that Cameroon, Nigeria, the Sudan are better off than Greece today. Yeah. Is there an element of sabotage in all of this business? I heard one of them giving an account on the BBC saying that he has spent 2 years in the Libyan desert from Cameroon, spending 2 years in the Libyan deserts, for God's sake, and he came from Douala.
Yes, I think all the, particularly the illegal immigrants, are also very aware of how the European economy is evolving. In the past years, Greece, Spain were the most important territory where they wanted to land. Mm-hmm. But now you are noticing it is not Greece, Italy, Spain are just transit territories. Mm-hmm. They want to go to Germany, where the opportunity to have a job and employment is more interesting. They want to go to some specific areas in Great Britain. Mm-hmm. They want to go to some specific areas in Northern Europe, mm-hmm, where they can find job opportunities. I think these are just entry points. Greece, France, Spain have become entry points. Their final destination is Germany. Their final destination is Northern Europe countries like Netherlands,
Swedish, Norway, and so on.
So they are very aware of how European economy works, where job opportunities lies, and where finally it can be better to stay and to invite the family to come.
Okay. Do you think that the push factor is Africa or the Middle East, where there are conflicts or where there are problems? But let's look at the push factor on how African governments can solve the problem. You know that this is an issue that directly concerns them, because when they talk of 800 people dying a day in a single boat, those are people who can contribute to the 2035 vision, 2020 vision across these countries. Do you think that African governments somehow have failed? Because most of those who are traveling say they want to go and play football in Europe, because if you play in Kanon of Yaoundé, if you play in Zamalek of Egypt, you will never be Africa's best footballer of the year. The fact that some African institutions have failed to live by example, because even when you look at our governments, a majority of our political stars, ministers, prime ministers, foreign affairs ministers, and whatsoever you can imagine, are people who studied in Europe. And okay, them to say, okay, for you to become a football star, for you to become a political star, for you to become a musician who is a star, you need to have a European experience. The fact that our local stars are not given opportunities to shine at home, can it contribute them going there?
I think, Charles, the reality of migration is more complex than the current situation we are witnessing. The relationship between Europe and Africa is a very ancient relationship. And yes, for the current situation, we can analyze it through the ways you are indicating. But we should not forget that it is, when you consider from the 16th century to the 19th century, there has been the slave trade. And there have been, during even the slave trade, millions of people, 10 million, left Africa on forced migration to go to Europe. And this has created a link between the two continents. Now, it is clear that when you go back to how employment policies work in Africa, how general politics are managed in Africa, you can find some grounds to make some changes. And these changes are really necessary. And if you witness the way migration is returning to the international headlines, it is becoming an emergency situation.
Sure, an emergency situation. And that is why the European Union wants to tackle the issue once and for all. Over the weekend, European leaders met in an emergency session in Brussels, and they have proposed a series of actions. Military, they have to redouble or triple their budgets even in tackling this issue. Do you think that the Brussels package is enough to solve the problem?
What I think is the Brussels package is necessary, particularly increasing and tripling the budget. That was an absolute good decision. But I'm not sure it will be the only way of solving this critical issue. Because, for instance, the European packages failed to address the issues of quotas, how to split the huge amounts of migrants.
The French all over government, Francois Hollande, says he is ready to host 500 to 700 of the migrants.
But if you compare this offer with the volume of migrants,
that about 35,000.
So you see, it is almost already insufficient. Well, I think what is necessary to do it is to reinforce the cooperation with Africa. There are two routes that can be followed, according to me. There is the route of continuing the signing of accords between African countries and European Union, helping the creation of jobs through Africa. There is a project that has been abandoned, the one of creating job centers in Africa to capture all these migrants and give them decent jobs. I think this is one trajectory that needs to be explored, and to be explored seriously. The second one is encouraging legal migration, because, Charles, it is not everybody that is going to Europe to stay to Europe. You, as a journalist, have traveled several times to Europe. I have traveled several times to Europe, but our people living there, studying there, should be given more and more opportunities to come back. And the ideas of having monetary incentives for legal migrants that want to go back to Africa is one of the trajectories that needs to be explored. And I think the increase of budget should also go to such programs where people who have studied in Europe to acquire some skills can go back to the continent and have some money to start their new life in the continent and bring back the knowledge they have acquired to Europe. I think also the cooperation should be reinforced with African institutions, not only NGOs, not only government, but with some African institutions. And I think the think tanks can be one of the recipient of all these amount of aid that is proposed to tackle this issue. Why the think tanks can be necessary? The think tank can be necessary because they can observe, they can disseminate information on migration all over Africa. They can analyze data. They can inform also the organization, the NGOs. They can inform the youth association. They can do some campaigning, some advocacy about fighting illegal migration and supporting government on these issues. So I think there is a huge package of measures that should be taken to try to tackle this phenomenon. But it is very good that the latest breakdown on this issue has captured top European leaders' attention and lead to this summit, which very important decisions.
Probably before we end in about 5 minutes from now, one of the issues discussed by the European leaders is that of a military solution. There will be tracking and following of traffickers and smugglers of migrants across the Mediterranean. There will be planes, there will be ships to counter the operations. The main issue is here is to end the entry points of places like Misrata or places like Bani Wali.
I think nobody
would the military solution be counterproductive?
I think it is a question of means, because you know Mare Nostrum has been stopped because it was unsustainable for just the only Italian
just six government. Countries supported Italy for the moment, and Matteo Renzi says that we can't fight the battle alone.
So that is very clear. So it depends on the means that the European Union will agree to put in this new formula of, I can say, Mare Nostrum or Triton. It is Triton that is going to be relaunched, mm-hmm. but with more powerful means, more important military means, aircraft, navy seals, and so on. I think it is just part of the solution. Mm-hmm. Part of the solution is controlling Libya and making Libya recovering. Because if there is no long-term stability in Libya, for the moment, you cannot solve the problem of Libya being the gateway to Europe. Okay. And I think this is where the issue lies.
I introduced to you as one person who has been working on this issue of migration over the years. You wrote a portion of this book, Immigration et Diaspora, Un regard africain, edited by Professor Jean-Emmanuel Pondi. From a scientific point of view, from a research point of view, what can be the long-standing solutions to end this tragedy?
I think the long-standing solution to end this strategy, first of all, is to create conditions for every human being around the globe to be well living where he is, be in Africa, in Europe, or in America. It is the long-standing solution. It is to try to split the world, the growth all over the countries in the world. But it is also an idealistic solution that cannot work. Mm-hmm. The other thing with this piece of research we have done is that the world should not just focus on the fact that migration from Europe to Africa is occupying the headlines. Mm-hmm. African migrants have first destination is another African country, and this is what we found in this book. Mm.
Okay, so there should be more of inter-African movement rather than a perilous journey across the Mediterranean.
For the African migrants, the solution is Africa integration.
Okay.
This is what we found in this book. Okay. For the African migrants, the solution is reinforcing Africa integration.
Okay. Dr. Christian Put, the head of Center for Strategic Studies. Thanks very much for accepting our invitation on Global
Watch. Thanks for your invitation.
And just to tell our audience that if they want to get more information on how to understand the issues more deeply, they can read Immigration et Diaspora Africaine, un regard africain sur la direction de Jean-Emmanuel Pondi. Ladies and gentlemen, before we separate, my next guest on this program is the special or personal advisor of the German Chancellor Angela Merkel for Africa, Guten Nuke. He was in Cameroon recently to discuss cooperation issues between Germany and Africa. And in the next 5 minutes, he explores to me how Germany will use a presidency of the G7 to solicit and canvas for development aid for Africa.
We have decided in the German Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development that we want to launch an additional initiative in the health sector with all the lessons learned from the Ebola crisis in the last year, so that we have organized and spent money in a total amount of 205 million euro. And I'm here in Cameroon to offer this program to the Cameroonians. That means 16 million euro for this and the next year for Cameroon in the sector of health care, and especially mother mortality here in Cameroon. That is a national program that is in the interest of the of President Biya, and so we want to support the own engagement of the Cameroonian government and to prolong our successful support in the healthcare sector with our development agencies, GIZ, and the development bank, KfW. And we have also launched a program with the CEMAC, the OSEAC organization here in Yaoundé, so that there's additional money for the entire region, and Cameroon will also profit from this program that is about AIDS prevention, HIV AIDS prevention, and the issue of detectable tropical diseases. That means also cooperation in the of universities and clinics.
Okay, you are like the Mr. Africa of Germany. The next G7 meeting will be taking place in Germany. How much of Africa will be in that agenda?
The German government and Chancellor Angela Merkel herself decided to invite for this development session, that is a lunch session, on the second day, that means on 8th of June in Germany, in the Free State of Bavaria, to invite African leaders from Senegal, Nigeria, South Africa, Ethiopia, Tunisia, and Liberia, and the chairperson of the African Union Commission, Madam Zuma, so that we have a big and also representative group of leaders from Africa to speak about development issues, post-2015 agenda, also the new sustainable development goals, but also, of course, maybe the issue of lessons learned from the Ebola crisis and the healthcare sector.
Most African countries today are suffering from severe security challenges. Just tell me, how concerned is
the German Chancellor vis-à-vis terrorism, and here in particular about Boko Haram and Al-Shabaab, who are creating extensive chaos in Somalia and the whole of the West African belt?
I had meetings with the foreign minister and also the president, and in both meetings the security issues and Boko Haram was one of or the most important subject we have discussed, and the German Chancellor is very much committed and pushing this issue also in the German and European bodies that we will financing or give financial support from Europe to the new regional forces of the ECOWAS, and where also Cameroon, Chad and Nigeria will be involved to combat Boko Haram. And we hope that also the Nigerian government and the new president will be committed to establish his new force.
It's been long ever since a German chancellor stepped legs in Africa, let alone Cameroon, since Herman Kurt was here. Can we in the nearest future have any a German chancellor visiting any African country?
I think it's very clear that the German chancellor is coming to Africa, but we haven't decided in which country she is going.